That's how you change the world. Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
All right, welcome everybody to our midweek service. We could all find our seats and turn in our Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 2. If anyone's here tonight need a Bible, put your hand up in the air. We'll make sure we get one over to you. Otherwise, 1 Samuel chapter 2. As we continue our journey verse by verse through the Word of God. Last time we were introduced to a man named Elkanah, who had two wives. One wife, Peninnah, had bore him many kids, but the other, Hannah, you remember, was barren. And you'll also remember how Peninnah relentlessly teased Hannah over the fact that she couldn't have children, which just exacerbated Hannah's sadness. Now, Hannah was a godly woman, but she was a woman of great sorrow. And though Elkanah tried hard to comfort Hannah, and though he tried hard to communicate to her just how much she was loved and blessed, nothing short of having a baby was going to appease her heart. So you remember how one day when Elkanah had brought the family to Shiloh in order to celebrate one of the feasts, Hannah made her way over to the tabernacle, which was in Shiloh at that time, and she went to the tabernacle. She cried out to the Lord, and she said, God, if you will give me a son, then I'll give him right back to you. And she said, he'll be set apart at birth. She makes that Nazarite vow. She says, he will be consecrated unto you. And then Eli, the priest, comes along. He blesses Hannah's prayer. And sure enough, Hannah conceives. She has a son. She names him Samuel. And she raises Samuel up until the time that he is weaned, till he's about 3 years old. Then Hannah honors her vow to God, and she takes Samuel and turns him over to Eli the priest, where he will be raised up there in the tabernacle. When we left off, there at the end of chapter 1, there was Hannah and Elkanah worshiping at the house of God, and chapter 2 begins with Hannah praying to the Lord. Before we get into Hannah's prayer, let's pray ourselves. Lord, we lift up this night to you, and we thank you for another opportunity to gather in your house, to worship together, to fellowship together, Lord, and to study your word together. I pray, God, that your Holy Spirit would fall on this place, and I pray that you would speak to us, God, powerfully through your word, and that each of us would have the ears and the hearts to hear, to understand, and obey. We offer this night to you, God. Again, we ask for your blessing, your anointing upon us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Verse 1, and Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord. And this just proves what we talked about last time, that Hannah had not in any way tried to manipulate God into giving her a child for selfish reasons. Her desire for having a child was not to shut the mouth of Peninnah, her adversary. It was not for the purpose of finding her identity or her self-worth or, you know, her fulfillment in that child. Her sole purpose for wanting a child, and particularly a son, was so that she could have something very valuable so that she could then in turn give that treasured possession back to God, her most valuable possession in the world. And she comes along, and here she is. She's praying, she's worshiping, she's rejoicing. How many of us could worship and rejoice on the very day that we give away our three-year-old son to be raised by someone else? But that's what she did, because what brought her the most joy and the most fulfillment was making the ultimate sacrifice unto God, who she knew one day was going to make an ultimate sacrifice for her. the rest of the world, for that matter. Look at what she says. My horn is exalted in the Lord. A horn is used many places in the Bible as a picture of strength. My strength is in the Lord. I smile at my enemies. Peninnah had treated Hannah with great cruelty. She sought to lead Hannah into the lowest depths of depression. But Hannah, in return, seeks not to tear down, but to lift up her enemies. And she says, because I rejoice in your salvation. And this word for salvation goes far beyond the idea of Hannah being saved and delivered from her barrenness or the cultural embarrassment and shame that came with that in that day. This is a reference to the Messiah, the Christ, who will save and deliver her from her sins. This is how she can rejoice even in the midst of the great sacrifice that she is making. She had a big picture mentality. She had an eternal perspective. She's making what is a tremendous sacrifice unto God. In our giving unto God, whether it's our money or our time, our gifts and talents, whatever it is, the point is our giving should be sacrificial. It's commanded to be sacrificial, meaning it should be to the level to where it costs you something. What you give should cost you something. You've heard the term, give till it hurts. Well, that might sound noble, but that falls short of sacrificial giving. Because sacrificial giving is not giving up until the point that it hurts and then you stop. It's continuing to give beyond the point of hurt. If it doesn't sting a little, you might be giving out of the abundance of your wealth or out of the abundance of your talents, but you're not giving out of the abundance of your heart. If you're tithe or you're serving, the giving of your time and talents, if it doesn't cause hardship, then there was no sacrifice involved. And you and I are able to give sacrificially. You know, when the world looks at what I'm saying right now, they look at that pastor, he just wants to rob us of our money. I mean, that's what all pastors do, right? But you and I can give sacrificially, and we can serve to the point to where it causes hardship in our lives, and we can rejoice in that process when we are able to keep the proper perspective of why it is that we give and serve sacrificially in the first place. And the reason is that sacrificial giving and sacrificial serving is the only kind of giving and serving that correctly emulates the heart of our Lord and Savior and the great sacrifice that He made for us on the cross. Hannah says to God, I give to you this great sacrifice, and I do so with tremendous joy. How and why? Because she says to God, that's what your Messiah, that's what your son is going to do for me. I give you my son, I sacrifice my son for you, because one day you're going to sacrifice your son for the entire world. He's going to lay down his life, not just willingly, but he's going to lay down his life with great joy. His sacrifice is going to come with great joy. We look at Hebrews 12:2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Think about that. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. I can't think of anything in this world that I would be more afraid of, or anything that I would dread more than the prospect of being literally nailed to a cross. But as horrific of a prospect as that was, we're told in Hebrews 12 rightly that Jesus endured it not with great consternation, but with great joy. Why? Because he loved us so much. And that's what it took. That was the level of love that it took in order to save you and I from sin and death and hell. And so Hannah had the right perspective. She rightly understood that the sacrifice she was making unto God, though it was huge in the moment, It was a colossal sacrifice from this earthly human perspective. She's giving her only child. Still, it paled in comparison to the sacrifice that she knew God was going to make one day on her behalf. So she continues in her prayer, verse 2, "No one is holy like the Lord, for there is none beside you, nor is there any rock like our God." And then she rebukes the proud and the arrogant. Remember, she had been brought down low because of her inability to have children, and now God lifts her up. And it's the arrogant now that are left to deal with God. And so she says, "Talk no more so very proudly. Let no arrogance come from your mouth." Hannah dealt with a lot of persecution, even in her own home, just because she was, you know, she dealt with that persecution, not because so much she was bearing, but a godly woman. When you become someone who is an outspoken defender of truth in the gospel, you're someone who has no compromise with the world in your life, most people aren't going to like that. Most people aren't going to like you. And even some who call themselves Christians, even some who call you friend. And they're going to seek to bring you down. And they're going to say mean and nasty things about you. But what Hannah is communicating is, forget about what your adversaries are saying about you for the sake of righteousness. As a result of you having no compromise with the world, and as a result to your complete commitment unto God, don't worry about what they're saying. They're arrogant and they're proud, and the Lord is in the business of bringing down the arrogant and the proud. He is in the business of shutting the mouths of the arrogant and the proud. And ultimately, God is going to have the final say in your life. The Lord is our defender. For the Lord is the God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. Hannah possesses great wisdom as it relates to her own spiritual well-being, as well as what constitutes an effective prayer life. You and I can certainly learn a lot from the way she prays here, because no matter what you're walking through, no matter how dark or bleak the situation, as you are petitioning God, every prayer should start out with praise and an acknowledgement of the power and the sovereignty of God, because again, it's going to put me on the right path. It's going to put me on the right perspective of knowing that whatever problem I might have and whatever problem I'm bringing to God, whatever I ask of God, he is bigger than my problem. I've already established that before I started praying, before I started asking, petitioning. And we call God Almighty God, but then sometimes we act like he is somewhat mighty or partially mighty. And my problem is much bigger than him. But again, it's the perpetual awareness and acknowledging of the greatness and the almightiness of God that keeps my heart and my mind and my life and my prayer life in the right perspective. And the right perspective is this, two things. God's will is going to come forth from any situation, number one. And then number two, God's will is always going to produce the greatest outcome related to my spiritual well-being. Boom. The bows of the supposed mighty men are broken, and those who stumbled are girded with strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, and the hungry have ceased to hunger. And it's the idea that God humbles the proud, and he exalts the humble. Even the barren has borne 7. And she who has many children has become feeble. The Lord kills and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and brings up. In other words, the Lord is in charge of life. He's in charge of death. And he's in charge of everything in between. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and lifts up. He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the beggar from the ash heap. to set them among princes and make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. Speaking of the earth's orbit and all, and how the earth just is suspending there in the universe. Because we live in a world where Satan has been given dominion, it may look at times like God has abandoned the earth. But make no mistake about it, everything that happens on this planet is under the watchful eye of God. That's what Hannah's getting at in her prayer. Even the dominion that man has given unto Satan, Satan only controls in this world what God allows. Now, he's called the God of this world, but this world is still God's property. God is still the owner. Satan is what we would call a squatter. God gave Adam, he gave man dominion over earth, and then man gave that dominion to Satan when he sinned, when he rebelled against God. But one day, God's going to take back. He's going to come, he's going to take back what is rightfully his. He's going to take back possession of this earth. If you look over in Revelation chapter 5, you have this setting in heaven that is right before the return of Christ, where God is holding a scroll in his right hand that has seven seals on it. And an angel begins this search all over heaven as to who might be worthy to come and break the seals and thus be able to open the scroll. And of course, it's the Lion of the tribe of Judah that comes forth as the one who is worthy. But what that scroll is that God is holding in his right hand, it is the title deed to the planet Earth. And of course, when those seals begin to be loosed one at a time, it unleashes hell on earth. It's the beginning of the tribulation period, which is also the beginning of God taking back possession of what is rightfully his, the earth. Now, there's one thing that's really interesting in relation to that scene that I just talked about in Revelation chapters 5 and 6, and it's kind of off topic, but that's okay. I think you'll appreciate this because it's one of the greatest evidences of a pre-trib rapture of the church. Hold your place there in 1 Samuel, and I want you to turn in your Bibles all the way to the back to Revelation chapter 5. Revelation chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. This is the Apostle John, his vision. And I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back sealed with seven seals. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals?" And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. Skip down to verse 6. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Then he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. So the Lamb of God, Jesus, is found worthy to take the scroll. He comes, he takes the scroll from God the Father, And he's the one worthy to loosen its seals. And then watch what happens next in this heavenly scene. Now, when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, not the Old Testament songs, but a new song saying. And the words of this song are important and very revealing, but first we need to recognize who it is that is singing as well as who is not singing. Who are the four living creatures? Well, it's hard to say because the Bible doesn't give us much to go on. Many believe that these are the full representation of God's creation, since you had the face of a man, the face of an ox, the face of a lion, and the face of an eagle. It's described in Revelation chapter 4. Just take my word for it. But obviously it's representing man, representing domestic animals, representing wild animals, and then, of course, the birds. And by the way, if you're up to date and you're one year Bible reading, though the descriptions are slightly different, many commentators believe that these are the same four creatures that Ezekiel saw in his vision in Ezekiel chapter 1, which we read about yesterday. So who are the 24 elders? Again, it's hard to say who they are individually. The Bible isn't clear on that, but we can, without a doubt, say and know that they are the church. And I'm going to give you several reasons why. Back in Revelation chapter 4, we're told that these 24 elders are seated around the throne. Ephesians talks about how we, the church, will be seated with Christ in heavenly places. The 24 elders, it's told, are clothed in white robes, which is symbolic all throughout Scripture of being clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. The 24 elders are also described as wearing golden crowns. James, the brother of Jesus, talks about you and I receiving the crown of life. But the most compelling evidence that this is a representation of God's creation, as well as the church there gathered around the throne of God, are the words that are being sung here in this scene, in this picture in heaven. They sang a new song saying what? You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. Now, this can't be the angels singing this song, because have angels or cherubim been redeemed by the blood of Christ? No. Will angels be made kings and priests and be given the privilege of ruling and reigning with Christ on earth? No. Only the church can make those claims and sing the lyrics that's being sung in this song. You have redeemed us to God, it says. By your blood, you have made us kings and priests. We shall reign on earth. So the angels and cherubim that are present there in heaven, they refrain from singing this part because it doesn't apply to them. And then after these words of redemption are sung, we're told that then the angels join in with the next stanza of the song, and these are words then that everybody in the universe can sing along and say yes and amen to. And these words are, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. So this is without a doubt, guys, the church in heaven worshiping Jesus in Revelation chapter 5. Why is that significant? It's significant because all this is going on while the earth is in the middle of the Great Tribulation. Or it could be that the tribulation hasn't even started yet, because, at any rate, Antichrist hasn't been revealed on the earth at this point. Because Jesus is standing there with that scroll, and it's got the seven seals on it, and it's the first seal. When it's broken, Jesus is holding that scroll. When he breaks that first seal, that first seal is the unveiling of Antichrist upon the earth. And it's the unveiling of his fury then on the earth. And that doesn't happen until after what we just read about in Revelation chapter 5. In fact, turn over to chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6, verse 1. Now I saw when the Lamb opened up one of the seals, the first seal, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a white horse. Jesus, when he returns, will be riding on a white horse. And the Antichrist is just an imitator of Jesus. He's a counterfeit. Behold, a white horse, he who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. And so Antichrist is unveiled, revealed in the world during or just before the Great Tribulation, while the church is in heaven worshiping Jesus, having already been raptured off of this earth. And I agree with Hannah's prayer. You can turn back to 1 Samuel chapter 2. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. This is God's earth. Always has been. And his plan to redeem it will be facilitated perfectly according to his will. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 9, Hannah continues, he will guard the feet of his saints, but the wicked shall be silent in darkness, for by strength no man shall prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken in pieces. From heaven he will thunder against them. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. So no matter what man declares, it's God who's going to have the last word upon this earth, and he's going to judge the earth according to this very word of God right here that most of the world is protesting against right now. That's going to be the standard. That's going to be the judge. He will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his anointed. Again, the crux of Hannah's prayer is the recognition of the work that God did in her in granting her a child, in that it is yet another step. Not that it's, you know, that she's, you know, rejoicing so much of what this meant to her personally, but she understood that this is yet another step in God bringing about his ultimate work and his ultimate plan of bringing forth his anointed, his Messiah. So Hannah recognizes that Samuel is just one more child, one more birth, one more generation, one step closer to the birth of the Messiah. And she says, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And then Elkanah, verse 11, went to his house at Ramah, but the child ministered to the Lord before Eli, the priest. The Living Bible gives the translation. It says the child became the Lord's helper. We're told in verse 12, now the sons of Eli were corrupt, and here's why. They did not know the Lord. They were raised up in the tabernacle. They were raised up in the ways of the Lord. And like many today, they knew of the Lord, but they did not have their own personal relationship with God. So you have two sons of the high priest, not even believers, but were working as priests in God's tabernacle, which always spells trouble. Church leaders who do not have a personal relationship with God equals corruption every time. And the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered a sacrifice, what they were supposed to do according to the law, when a person brought a sacrifice, a portion of the animal was to be given to God. So it was to be broken up into thirds. A portion was to be given to God, the first portion, the best portion, obviously. Another portion was to be given to the priests to support them. And then a third portion was to be given back to the person who had brought the offering for him to be able to go back and take that meat to the family. And then the whole point is they would all be, you know, dining together. They would all be fellowshipping together with God. God consumes a portion of the meat. The family who brought the meat would consume a portion. The priest would consume a portion. It's like sharing a meal with God. But the priest's portion, according to the law, it was supposed to be, they were supposed to be given the breast and the shoulder of the animal, but somewhere along the line, the priests themselves came up with their own custom, and out of greed, what they would do, it says the priest's servant would come with a three-pronged flesh hook in his hand while the meat was boiling. Then he would thrust it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot, and the priest would take for himself all that the flesh hook brought up, which was obviously a whole lot more than just getting a breast and shoulder. So It says they did in Shiloh to all the Israelites who came there. And not only that, also before they burned the fat. Now the fat was considered to be the best portion of the animal. You know, it's the juiciest, it smells the best, it tastes the best. And it was supposed to be, the fat was supposed to be God's portion. And so you had to burn the fat first for God to get the first and the best portion. But these guys were demanding their portion, these priests were demanding their portion even before God got his, before they burned the fat. It says, the priest's servant would come and say to the man who sacrificed, give meat for roasting to the priest, for he will not take the boiled meat from you, but raw. So they were demanding the raw meat now. And then what they did, more than likely, you know, you couldn't go to the market and sell boiled meat, but you could take the raw meat to the market, and you could sell that and then pocket the money. And that's probably what they were doing. Either that or they were storing up the meat for themselves. At any rate, it says, and if the man said to him, they should really burn the fat first, then you may take as much as your heart desires. If the guy bringing the sacrifice says, listen, I know the law, what are you guys doing here? I mean, shouldn't God get his portion first? Shouldn't God get the first and best portion? And let's give God his portion, and then you can take what you want. Well, if the man said that, then the priest's servant would then answer him, no, but you must give it now, and if not, I will take it by force. Now, it'd be like in our context and culture, it'd be like a pastor giving one of those give me all your money messages, and then having a guy who's packing heat going from person to person, you know, with the offering plate, you know, like, bless you, bless you, bless you. Was that 100? Bless you. Marcus, you got the offering plate back there in the Colt 45? Okay, cool. So, it tells us here, very sadly, therefore, the sin of the young men was very great before the Lord. It gets worse. But I mean, it had gotten so bad that not only were these men fleecing the flock, but they were even willing to use violence and the threat of violence to get what they wanted out of the people. And because of that, notice, for men abhorred the offering of the Lord. And that's the saddest part. You got these two sons of Eli, and the corruption at that tabernacle had gotten so bad that God-fearing people dreaded and even hated going to church. And the only saving grace, one silver lining, was here's this little kid being brought up, Samuel. But Samuel ministered before the Lord, even as a child, wearing a linen ephod, or wearing the little priestly garb. Now, as Hannah rightly communicated in her praise to God and in her prayer, God is in control of this earth, and God is in control of his church. And no matter how corrupt men of the church might become, corrupt ministers will never stop or hinder the work of God. They never have. And they never will. And speaking of the work of God, look at how God answered Hannah's prayer of giving her a son. But at the same time, God's orchestrating this whole series of events that's going to result in God having someone now in the tabernacle who truly represented God's heart and God's character. Imagine having someone representing God's heart and God's character in God's house. I mean, that's a pretty cool concept, right? Isn't that the way it should be? But it wasn't. But God's orchestrating this many years in advance to raise up Samuel. God's work does not stop when God's ministers become corrupt. For these guys' names were Hophni and Phinehas, if you remember from last time, but For every Hophni and Phinehas, God raises up a Samuel. And here's this little kid truly representing God's heart, while these two adult men exploit and fleece God's people in the name of God under the guise of religion. But how cute it must have been to see little Samuel about the Lord's business, wearing his little priestly garb. It says, moreover, his mother used to make him a little robe and bring it to him year by year when she came up with her husband to offer the yearly sacrifice. That's another testament. We talked about this last time, but it's another testament of the faithfulness of Elkanah and Hannah during a very, very dark time in Israel. But they didn't let the corruption of the priests, the corruption of the church, keep them from honoring God and honoring God's law. A lot of people today, their excuse for not going to church is because the church is filled with sinners, they'll say. But, you know, you let sinners keep you away from a relationship with the Lord. I mean, talk about throwing the baby out with the bathwater. And the church certainly is filled with sinners. It's filled with imperfect people. It's filled with hypocrites. It's filled with some corrupt people, for sure. But it's also filled with a lot of those sinners who have had their sins forgiven and justified by the blood of Jesus. Sinners who are being renewed and sanctified day by day through the washing of water by the Word and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That's what heaven is going to be filled with, by the way. Forgiven sinners who have been clothed in the perfect righteousness of Jesus. But the irony, when a person says that they don't want to have anything to do with church and they don't want to have anything to do with Jesus because they hate being around sinners or they hate the idea of you know, giving to what might be a corrupt church or corrupt pastors or whatever. What if you don't like being around those kinds of people, and you don't like being around hypocrites, you don't like being around corrupt ministers, what do you think you're going to be surrounded by in hell? So don't ever let the corruption of imperfect man be what hinders you from entering into your own personal relationship with Jesus. I remember, this is kind of along the same vein, but I remember spending many years of my life confused about the gifts of the Spirit, and particularly speaking in tongues. And you know, I had been in lots of churches where that had gotten way out of context, and it turned into a big show and just a free for all. And it made me kind of, you know, just kind of, I don't want to go anywhere near that. But man had taken something that God had instituted, right? The gifts of the Spirit are real, and the gifts of the Spirit are operable today. But I was cheating myself out of God's best and out of you know, the fullness of God's blessings because of what man had taken and done with. And I finally got to the point one day, it's like, I'm not letting man cheat me out of anything that God wants to give me. And how foolish it is to let man cheat you out of salvation. It's just downright dumb. And obviously, you know, I'm not saying that anyone should attend a church that has become corrupt, but rather, don't dismiss the church as a whole. Don't let a corrupt, counterfeit church rob you and keep you from abiding in Christ and being a part of the true church. Because I promise you, there will always be a true church. And you will always be able to find it if you want to. Now, back in those days, the days of Hannah and all, there was only one church. There was only one tabernacle. And you had no choice. And as we see, there was a tremendous corruption in the tabernacle at that point. There was tremendous corruption in the tabernacle, in the temple, in Jesus' day. But Elkanah and Hannah didn't allow it to hinder their relationship with God nor to dishonor what God commanded them to do through the law. See, it didn't matter if the tabernacle had become corrupt. God still required for them to come and to worship and to tithe and to make sacrifices, no matter how corrupt the church might have become, the priests and all. And God's going to handle these corrupt priests, by the way. He always does. He's gonna sit things right side up, as he always does. And James talks about not all should become teachers. Not all should become pastors. Why? Because, as James says, we are held to a higher accountability. We're held to a higher responsibility and therefore subject to a stricter judgment of what we do with God's word and how we minister to God's people. You better go into ministry knowing that and understanding it and having a great fear and respect of it. Because God's going to handle corrupt pastors and leaders. God has always preserved for himself a remnant. God has always, through dark times, raised up men like Samuel to lead. And we as pastors, we got to decide, you know, who do you want to be? Do you want to be a Samuel? Do you want to be a Phinehas? And God gives you that choice, but, well, you know the consequences of your choices. Or you better know. And then you'll have people, other people that don't go to church because they think that, again, pastors are all alike, and ultimately the job of a pastor is just to, you know, to ask for money and just to just get you to give as much as you possibly can, you know, they need to buy jets and Lamborghinis and that kind of thing. I remember, was it T.D. Jakes? Somebody asked him, "Why? How do you go before your congregation wearing a $5,000 suit?" And he goes, "Well, I can't very well teach a prosperity doctrine by wearing cheap clothes, can I?" But many believe that we're here to rip you off, every pastor, and so they don't go to church. And you know, Jesus even said that in the last days, as it gets closer and closer to the time that he's getting ready to come, these what he described as wolves in sheep's clothing, they're going to become more and more on the scene. And, you know, people that are in it for filthy lucre's sake, for money. It's one of the reasons why we don't pass an offering plate or even talk about money here unless it comes up in Scripture as we're teaching verse by verse through the Bible. And I think it's one of the many ways that we stay above reproach. Because what you give to this church, you're not giving to this church. You're giving to God through this church. And what you give to God, frankly, is none of my business. Nor is it my place to ever try to pressure you or guilt you into giving more. And besides, if your giving is lacking or not up to par with the sacrificial standard that God has set in his word, the Holy Spirit's going to do a far better job dealing with that kind of heart than I ever could. Having said that, I think anybody would have a hard time ever accusing me or this church of you know, just being one that wants to rob people of money or in it for the money. Or if they say that this church is robbing people of money, they're going to have to blame the Holy Spirit. And I think he's probably okay with that. A lot of people are shocked, you know, coming from denominational backgrounds the first couple times they come here and they're looking for the offering plate. Like, wait a minute, they're done? He just dismissed us and nobody, and it happens a lot. People ask, but I had a guy ask me a couple months ago, and this guy was an accountant for a huge Baptist church in Nashville, and he was helping the bank there with our financial records and going over our records and all. And but he said to me on the phone, he's like, "How in the world is your church flourishing and doing so well financially without you ever taking up an offering? How is that even possible?" I mean, he was intrigued. I said, well, it's a three-step process. You should try it. One, you teach the word. Two, you rely on the Holy Spirit. Three, you repeat steps one and two over and over. I got way off base here tonight. All right, listen. Verse 20. Elkanah and Hannah didn't let the corruptness of man impede their devotion and, you know, their obedience unto the Lord. And every year, Hannah would come to the tabernacle. Each time she would bring little Samuel a new priestly robe, I'm sure every year, anticipating he's going to be a little bigger this year. In verse 20, Eli, the high priest, each time would bless Elkanah and his wife. He would pronounce a blessing upon them and say, the Lord give you descendants from this woman for the loan that was given to the Lord. And then they would go to their own home. So this happened for at least multiple years where Eli the high priest would bless them and with this prayer, may the Lord give you more children. And then they would return home. And we're told, verse 21, though, that after some time, the Lord visited Hannah so that she conceived and bore, look at this, three sons and two daughters. So Hannah gave one child to the Lord. The Lord gave her back five. And God will be indebted to no man. Meanwhile, the child Samuel grew before the Lord. Now Eli was very old, and he heard everything his sons did to all Israel and how they lay with the women who assembled at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. So not only were they crooks and charlatans, they also were involved in sexual immorality with some of the women of the church. And so Eli said to them, goes to his son, says, why do you do such things? For I hear of your evil dealings from all the people. I mean, this isn't just rumor. This is not just one or two people that's brought this. Everybody's saying and telling me what you guys are doing. No, my sons, for it is not a good report that I hear. You make the Lord's people transgress. Now imagine priests, God's representatives, that their behavior would be so bad and so depraved that even indirectly, forget about luring and seducing, you know, women into sexual favor and that kind of thing, but just even indirectly their behavior is causing people to want to stay away from church, causing people to not come to the tabernacle and honor God and honor the law. Like people are like, I'm not going to that tabernacle and get ripped off by those priests and go in there and get threatened with violence. And then the problem with that is they themselves would be sinning, though, by staying away from the tabernacle and not honoring the law. So the priests, both directly and indirectly, are causing the people that they're supposed to be ministering to, causing the people to sin. And then also seducing godly women, or at least women who came to the tabernacle with good intentions, the priest seducing them into sexual immorality. What an abomination. But you know, you and I, if you call yourself a Christian, you're not a priest, but if you call yourself a Christian, you're declaring to the world that you now are a representative of God. You're a representative of God in the world. I told the men at the last men's breakfast, I said, if you are a Christian, you are in full-time ministry. It might not be your profession, but you're in full-time ministry. You're God's representative where you work, in your home, in your community, in the world. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. For the true Christian, the idea is, I accepted Jesus. That means I'm dead. And what you see now, when you look at me, and what you see being lived out, it's no longer me, but it's Christ. It's the heart of Christ being lived out in and through me. And so that's what it means to be a Christian. But when we say that, we make that association with Christ in the world, and then we sin, well, then the sin is a direct reflection not so much on us, but on Jesus. Well, wait a minute, you're representing Jesus, and this is Jesus being lived out? Is that what Jesus does? I don't want any part of that. Because we've communicated, we've misrepresented the true heart of Christ, and we've put a stain upon our testimony because we have communicated to everyone around us that Jesus is either not really overly concerned with sin, or if he is, he's not powerful enough to deliver anyone from its bondage. Either way, we've misrepresented the truth in the heart of Christ, and that in and of itself causes other people to then trip and stumble in their own relationship with the Lord. It's one thing to sin yourself, but to cause others to sin is a whole different level of judgment that you are bringing upon yourself. What about husbands? And these you're talking about, I'm talking about in Christian homes, husbands luring their wives into things that are detestable, like pornography, causing their Christian wife to sin. And it goes far beyond that sometimes. But Jesus says, you cause one of these little ones to stumble. Little ones meaning new, especially immature believers. Jesus says, it would be better for you to have a 2,000-pound stone fastened around your neck and thrown into the ocean than what God's going to do to you. I think about how many Christians, you know, if they're in a dating relationship, Christians dating today, and as I've said many times, we live in a culture where nobody bats an eye at premarital sex anymore or fornication. How many Christians have been coerced or lured into sexually immoral behavior by other Christians? When I sit in counseling, or if I'm doing premarital counseling, especially, you know, if it's a young couple, but every time, I will ask them, is there any sexual immoral behavior going on in your relationship? And if there is, you need to stop and you need to repent right now. And if you're not willing to do that, you need to go get somebody else to marry you. That's how serious God takes it. And you know, there have been times where the woman has been, listen, I didn't want to, but, you know, he's telling me he's going to leave me. And, you know, he's telling me that, you know, if I really love him and all this kind of stuff. And I said, let me tell you something. That is a red flag right off the bat. Why would you, I'll look at the woman, I said, why would you want to marry a man who is already proving to you before you even get married that he is not able or willing to protect your spiritual well-being? There was a guy that used to come to our church. This was back in the very beginning. And this guy, he loved the Lord, so we thought. But he had invited a whole lot of friends to church. He was a young guy. He was in college. And all of a sudden, you know, we had this whole slew of 20-somethings in our church, college students, you know, who seemed, most of them, all of them seemed to be on fire for the Lord. It was awesome. But this guy had let a young girl and her little daughter move in, you know, with him in his spare bedroom for a little while until she could get back on her feet. Because apparently the girl had been in some sort of abusive relationship she was trying to escape from. And, you know, she was no more than 22, 23 years old. But she had lived a hard life and had a rough upbringing and all. But he let her move in, you know, and was just extending, according to him, the love of Christ and all. And then he invited the girl to church. She came to church. And after a couple of weeks of coming to the church, she accepted the Lord. And I baptized her. And she seemed to be really getting, you know, her life together until one day we found out that the Christian guy who had let her stay in his house and had invited her to church and had introduced her to everybody. The church, turns out this guy had been demanding sexual favors from her in exchange for rent. And he didn't see anything wrong with it. And what kind of a negative impact do you think that made, not only on, of course, the guy's testimony, but how Christianity was being portrayed to now this brand new believer? It's an abomination. That's what kind of thing that Eli is having to address with his own sons here, who were priests, God's representatives. The problem with Eli, he wasn't corrupt like his sons. He was obedient unto his calling as high priest, as far as we know. But he was a terrible father, especially when it came to discipline. What these men have done is not only an embarrassment to Eli's family, but it's an embarrassment to the priesthood. It's an embarrassment to God. So Eli should have removed them from the priesthood. He should have excommunicated them from the tabernacle on the spot. But instead, he merely speaks to them. He gives them nothing but a warning, which then leaves it in the hands of God to not only come and judge them, but also God's going to judge Eli and how Eli mishandled this situation. And it's going to be something that comes with severe consequences. He says, if one man sins against another, God will judge him. This is Eli speaking to his sons. But if a man sins against the Lord, who will intercede for him? In other words, you guys are sowing seeds that's going to bring forth death and destruction. That's what you're doing. You're setting yourself up to be judged by God. Nevertheless, it says they did not heed the voice of their father because the Lord desired to kill them. Now, what does that mean? It means God warned them. God gave them room to repent and to turn from their sin, but they refused. And the Lord desired to kill them. Let that be a warning. Let that be a stern warning that all sin has to be judged. Justice must be served for God to remain a just God. And as far as judgment goes, we've learned from the book of Romans that the wages of sin is what? Say it again. Death. You know it. Now, you and I as Christians, as people, we have chosen to crucify ourselves and to let the life of Christ be lived out through us. But we have to decide daily, minute by minute, what I want my life to look like and what I want my life to reflect. Notice the two sons of Eli, their rebellion against God only grew more and more intense. Verse 26, though, just the opposite. And the child Samuel grew in stature and in favor, both with the Lord and men. And so Eli, though he seemed to be a terrible father, he seemed to have some positive influence on Samuel, at least. Then a man of God, an unnamed prophet, came to Eli and said to him, "Thus says the Lord, did I not clearly reveal myself to the house of your father," meaning Aaron, the father of the Aaronic priesthood, and Eli, of course, was a descendant of Aaron. "Did I not clearly reveal myself to the house of your father when they," Aaron and Moses, "were in Egypt, in Pharaoh's house? Did I not choose him out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priest, to offer upon my altar, to burn incense, and to wear an ephod before me? And did I not give to the house of your father all the offerings of the children of Israel made by fire?" In other words, God says, haven't I always taken care of my priests? You ever gone without anything? Haven't I always given you all that you need? All the way back to Aaron, I've taken care of the priests. And then the follow-up question to that is going to be, why then are you stealing from me? Why do you kick at my sacrifices and my offering, which I have commanded in my dwelling place, and honor, Eli, why do you honor your sons more than me, to make yourselves fat with the best of all the offerings of Israel, my people? Now, as far as we know, we don't know that Eli was directly involved in all the fleecing of the people, but the fleecing of the people was all happening on his watch. He's the high priest. And as we saw, even when he found out about it, he didn't do anything to stop it other than a little slap on the wrist. And I think when Eli didn't take the proper disciplinary action against his sons, that was the last straw with God. They're ripping people off. They're demonstrating violent behavior. They're seducing women into sexual immorality. And you're just going to let them remain in the priesthood? I mean, that's the way you handle this? Well, now there's going to be a consequence for Eli. Eli was the branch of Aaron's genealogy that the priesthood had been ordained by God to go through, but now God's going to take the priesthood away from Eli's lineage, and Solomon is going to fulfill that word from the Lord in 1 Kings 2:27. It says, so Solomon removed Abiathar, who was a descendant of Eli, removed Abiathar from being priest to the Lord that he might fulfill the word of the Lord which he spoke concerning the house of Eli at Shiloh. So God, not immediately, but eventually, God's going to remove Eli's descendants from being that branch of the family that's going to continue the Aaronic priesthood. He's going to give it to another branch of Aaron's family, a guy named Zadok. Verse 30, therefore, the Lord God of Israel says, I said indeed that your house and the house of your father would walk before me forever. And this is God talking to Eli through the mouth of this unnamed prophet. But now the Lord says, far be it from me, for those who honor me I will honor, and those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Behold, the days are coming that I will cut off your arm and the arm of your father's house. Meaning, arm is strength. I'm going to take away your strength. I'm going to remove strength from your family so that there will not be an old man in your house. None of Eli's descendants are going to live to be an old age. And you will see an enemy in my dwelling place despite all the good which God does for Israel. And that's going to be fulfilled in a couple of chapters. We get over to chapter 4 when the Philistines come and attack Shiloh and sack the tabernacle and all. And he says again, there shall not be an old man in your house forever, but any of your men whom I do not cut off from my altar shall consume your eyes and grieve your heart. In other words, not only are your descendants going to die young, but even the time that they are given on earth, your family, your descendants, Eli, they are not going to be a blessed people. And all the descendants of your house shall die in the flower of their age. He just reiterates that again. Now, since the fulfillment of this prophecy would not be fulfilled for many years, again, in the days of Solomon, God's going to give Eli an immediate sign in order to demonstrate the surety of this promise. Now, this shall be a sign to you that will come upon your two sons, on Hophni and Phinehas. In one day they shall die, both of them. And God says, you didn't deal with these boys, so now I'm going to. I think it's in chapter 3 when the Philistines come and attack, and Israel's getting beat up a little bit, and these guys think it's a good idea to go and get the Ark of the Covenant and take it out into battle. That's going to be their downfall. That was a big no-no. And so they're both going to die on the same day in battle. Then I will raise up for myself a faithful priest who shall do according to what is in my heart and in my mind. I will build him a sure house, and he shall walk before my anointed forever. Now, this is partially fulfilled in Samuel, because Samuel's going to function as a godly priest, effectively replacing the ungodly sons of Eli. It's also going to partially be fulfilled in Zadok in the days of Solomon, when Zadok, who is also the lineage of Aaron and Levi, Zadok's bloodline is going to take over as the branch that continues the Aaronic priesthood, replaces the branch of Eli. But this prophecy given here in 1 Samuel chapter 2 is ultimately going to be completely fulfilled in Jesus Christ when he returns to this earth as our high priest according to the order of not Aaron or Levi. Remember, Jesus is not of the tribe of Levi. He's not of the Aaronic priesthood. So he's not a part of the earthly, human, physical line of the priesthood But Jesus is the order of that eternal priesthood known as the order of, anybody know it? Melchizedek. You guys are good. Melchizedek, spoken of in Genesis chapter 14 and Hebrews chapter 5. Verse 36, it shall come to pass that everyone who is left in your house will come and bow down to him for a piece of silver and a morsel of bread and say, please put me in one of the priestly positions that I may eat a piece of bread. And so God's judgment, we're not getting to chapter 3 today, by the way, if you hadn't figured that out. You guys got way off on a tangent tonight. But did you like that? I mean, I love that in Revelation 5 and 6. It just gives us that picture of the church in heaven and escaping, as the Bible says, the great tribulation. But this is God's judgment, you know, upon Eli. Since much of the sins of Eli's sons was greed, they had stolen much from God's people, and though God had taken care of them and given them all of their needs as a family, it wasn't enough. They still wanted more. They still wanted to rob God's people, and to do so even through violence. And so God comes and he just flips it, as God always does. He turns it right side up. And so from here on out, instead of receiving their priestly portion, Eli's family would be reduced to that of beggars. That's what God is prophesying here. Again, God humbles the proud, and he blots out the name of the wicked. Let's pray. Father, we exalt your name in the universe. We magnify your name. We declare your holiness. We declare your majesty. We, your people, your creation, God, we do exactly what you designed us to do. We worship you. We bow our knees, we bow our hearts, we bow our lives before you. And we walk according to your grace. We walk according to your forgiveness. We walk in a way that shows complete gratitude for what you have done for us on the cross. And for those that don't, Lord, I pray that you would make them obedient men and women, that you'd help us to have this proper perspective that Hannah displayed in her prayer tonight, Lord, understanding that you are all-powerful and you are almighty, you are all-knowing, you are our all in all. You are our great provider, you are our Savior. And so, Lord, we give you honor and glory. We thank you for the power of your word and for the revelation of your word. We thank you for examples in your word of people who walk in faith and who walk in faithfulness, as well as examples of people who fail. And then you let us know, Lord, that we have a choice, each of us, as to how we want to be associated with your grace, with your forgiveness, living lives that rightly communicate your heart unto the world, or living lives that strictly and completely chase after the flesh and after sin. And we know what that road leads to, Lord, because your word is very thorough, and your word is very comprehending in that regard. And so, God, would you go before us? Would you light our path? Would you help us to walk in ways that bring glory and honor and pleasure unto your heart? Would you make us faithful men and women? And God, would you give us a strong voice for your truth and give us opportunities to walk out our faith, to demonstrate our faith, to share your love, to share your gospel, to share your truth, and to lead others into this close personal relationship that you have facilitated and manifested for each of us on the cross. Would you bless the rest of our week, God? Would you bless our church, bless our community? Would you bless this election coming up God. We ask that each of us would be able to go into that polling booth and to correctly represent your heart and who it is that you would set up as kings and leaders and officials and magistrates. We surrender to you, God, and we ask for your blessing. Even so, Lord, we pray that you would raise up leaders after your own heart. We would love it if you did that, God, but we trust whoever you put in office. Bless our week, Lord. Bless our church. Bless our community. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. If you need prayer, I'm available to pray with you after service. This Sunday, I'm going to be in John chapter 15, finishing up John chapter 15. So go ahead and read forward on that. If you'll all stand with me, we'll close. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. God bless you all.
That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.